May I seek that blessing to consider beside ministry of God's word. I was reading the thing the other day that said the statistics for young people when they graduate from the church, when they graduate high school, they were brought up in the church, says 70% of them don't come back. It says 70%. So to see a young person come up here and minister God's word, even seeing Jesse and Hector saying that they made the decision to serve God, young people that it's going to, you know, that we'll be able to pass things on to, that they would keep the church of God moving forward, it's a blessing. And one thing that I just want to bring out to this afternoon is just keeping God's presence in our life and basically just keeping Jesus in our life. And just one thing that I'm going to bring out today, and I'm going to close. And it's in 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 1 through 3. 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 1 through 3. It says, the men of Kirjath-Jearim came and fetched up the ark of the Lord and brought it into the house of Abinadab in the hill. And sanctified Eleazar, his son, to keep the ark of the Lord. And it came to pass while the ark abode in Kirjath-Jearim, that the time was long, for it was 20 years, all the house of Israel, and emanated over after the Lord. And Samuel spake unto all the house of Israel, saying, if ye do return unto the Lord with all your hearts, then put away the strange God, Ashtoreth, and among the, and prepare your hearts unto the Lord, and serve him only, it says, and he will deliver you out of the land of the Philistines. And we look at that picture I had before that, you know, basically Samuel brought the children of Israel to a decision. And everything that we see in life, you know, we're always going to face that decision in our life. We're going to look at two roads, a decision that we got to make, a decision that we got to make for our families, and a decision we got to make for ourselves. What are we? What road are we going to choose? What life are we going to choose for our life? For Christ. And here we look at 1 Samuel. He starts talking about, he starts talking to the children of Israel and telling them, hey, I want you guys we're going to make a decision today. He goes, God, we're going to serve God. You guys are going to serve God him only. And then he says, and then you're going to put away your gods, like turn from them. And what was taking place right now, the children of Israel at this time, they were surrounded by the Philistines. They were taking them over. They were just completely annihilating their military. Just took them out. And the Bible says they took the ark of God with them to their own encampment. And they thought they took it as a trophy, mocking God and saying, you know what? You know, we can do whatever we want, you know. And they took it, and a plague broke out in their land for 7 months. And so all kinds of stuff was taking place. But basically what took place is because the children of Israel at one point in their life, they begin to, they let go of the things of God. They let go of their life, their commitment to God. And I want to look at that this afternoon. See, a lot of things were going on in their life in Israel at this time. And Samuel brought them to a halt and brought them to the decision. You and I today, if, you know, we want God to move in our life all the way. Yeah. I don't want to leave God. Yeah. I've made it for these past 2 weeks. I've just ran into a lot of people that have walked away from God. Yeah. And, you know, the funerals that took place, it was crazy. But I look at my life and I'm like, I'm glad I stuck it out. I'm glad that I'm serving you, God, and I'm still here. I'm glad that whatever might take place in my life, that I haven't made the decision, you know, to let go. Because oftentimes, it's not so much that, you know, we're doing things to be deceptive or all these different things that are taking place in life. Sometimes we easily get persuaded in other things. We can get persuaded and look at, hey, a bunch of people here, we're having a barbecue. You know, you're going to go to church. Or, you know, why don't you do this? Or do that, or why do you go to church so much? Because basically, because they brought me to this point. It's where we find a, it's a place of refuge. See, if we're ever going to do anything for God, we got to have that within our life, have that decision, our decision to be made up. See, we understand the Philistines that should have the children of Israel oppressed, and all these things that were taking place in their life basically is because they left God, and they started worshiping other gods. See, as a trophy, he took it, and they took it, and it caused a lot of problems. And 1 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 4, and it says, chapter 7, First Chronicles chapter 7, verse 4, and it says, if my people were to be which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek thy face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear them from heaven, and I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. And basically, a lot of times we look at wicked ways, we probably picture a guy that's, you know, they probably shot somebody, or somebody that's heavily on drugs. Wicked ways could be anything. It could be lying, it could be cheating, it could be looking at things that, that we're not supposed to, things that will just eventually take us out of line, right? We start looking at one thing, and then it starts becoming more, and then it starts becoming more than that. When I was young, I started smoking. After that, I started trying a little bit of weed, and after that, I started trying a little bit of heavier drug, and I started taking alcohol, and it started progressing more and more. You know, but that's how the enemy starts. A lot of times we can look at that and say, you know what, it's not a big deal. See, at the time, the children of Israel looked at that like it was not a big deal. A lot of people say, I don't have to go to church. I don't have to live for God. You know, I could just, you know, come in whenever I want and make their own way. I had a friend of mine, he was, he's a mechanic out there in Fowler. And I was telling him, he was telling me, did you get your shot? I go, no, I didn't get a shot. I haven't even thought that before, yet, man. And he goes, like a customer came into my shop the other day, and he goes, hey, he goes, have you got your shot? He goes, no, I haven't been thinking about getting a shot. I don't think of. He goes, I got mine. And he goes, why haven't you got yours? He goes, well, because I haven't thought about it. You know, I don't really think I need to take it. And he goes, you know what, you need to shut up. And he goes, you need to let the government tell you what to do. And he goes, because the government knows best. And that guy goes, I go, what did you tell him? He goes, I ran around in the shop, man. But, you know, a lot of times, you know, people have their own way. And we might think, people might look at the things of God like it's foolish. They look at the ark of the Lord like it was just a box, like it was no big deal. But that ark, I know, it had the presence of God. Just if you were to touch it, you would die. But it's crazy if you look deep into that, how powerful it was. But God just shows us that. And the children of Israel allowed that to escape their hands. How does we allow God to just slip out of our hands in our lives? You know what happened? I thought you were saying, well, you know, I don't know. I thought you were used to go to church. Well, how do we allow it? What took the place? Right here, they were exposed. We look at the children of Israel. One of the things, he goes, you need to put your heart back to Christ. That was the first thing. Before the outward, it was, you need to come back to God. Put Him first in your life, right? Put Him first in our life. Well, I don't know if I can give up my Sundays. I don't know if I can do this. I don't know if I can do that. We need to put Him first. We know that the resurrection, all these things are taking place. Don't give us a thought to make for this year. Which way, what road am I going to take this year, 2021? Am I going to make my decision and just continue to live on? Like Josiah was saying, you know, not making a decision or making a step. Or I'm going to say, you know what, I'm going to put God first and see where it takes me. You know, what do I got to lose? You know, because when we serve God, you know, it affects not just our lives. And you see, man, just one person, how it affects so many people. You know, there are so much people in here that it was just crowded. We kind of figure that. But sometimes you might think in life that, you know, well, what kind of difference do I make? You know, it's no big deal, you know, but, you know, to live a little bit on this side and a little bit on that side. You don't have to be totally committed, right? True commitment, Pastor Manny, is for 40 years.
Yeah.
True commitment. Don't bring that up. And I got some. They're broken right now, but I'm going to get some. My wife, I just haven't had time. So bear with me. I'm already going to close. Some people might say, you don't have to go to church and all these different things, but you know what? If we listen to the lies of the enemy, you know, it could take us a different direction. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 9 says, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but long suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but all that should come to repentance. God says that he wants everyone to come to repentance. He wants everyone to be saved. He wants everyone to have a blessed life. You know, because a lot of times in life you make decisions and you can't get those things back. You can just learn from them. Psalm chapter 27 verse 4 says, one thing have I desired of the Lord. And this is David. Look at what he says about the church, basically the tabernacle of the church. One thing that have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house. This one thing that David says. He didn't say like, well, you know what else? I go to church, but you know what? I like watching football on the weekends, and I like doing my barbecues, and I like cooking this stuff on my days off. He says one thing, and this is in Psalm chapter 27, verse 4. He says, one thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. This is my decision, man. This is not something that I'm thinking about, or I'm going to check it out, or I'm going to do this for a time, and then later on, because all the days of my life, he says, this is my decision, to behold the beauty of the Lord and inquire of his temple. He says, to behold the beauty of the Lord and inquire of his temple. He says, man, I'm going to be there in church. You know, no matter what takes place, I know that I'm going to hear some good news. I'm going to hear something that I need to hear. Maybe I might have it all together, but you know what? It's going to help me stay on track. It's going to help me to stay focused so that I won't sway, that I keep Jesus first, that I don't go check out the girls on the side or do all these different things, that I come to the house of God and I hear something that strikes my heart that says, man, you need to get right because you're going to get lit. See, you and I today, the devil wants to destroy our lives, destroy our families and our loved ones more than anything, more than we know. The devil wants to wipe us out, mess up your family. He wants your kids to grow up without their father. He wants to do it more than anything that you know. If you don't believe me, just look at social media. If you don't believe me, just look at the news and all the beliefs and the craziness, the ideas that you don't need a man in the house, all these crazy corrupt thinking that is contaminating the thinking in the hearts of man today. And you know what? If we steer away from the Word of God, we're going to lose that. See, Romans chapter 8, verse 35, and I'm going to close with this. Romans chapter 8. Let me go there. 8, verse 35. It says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Who? You know, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? It says, shall tribulation? You know, nothing should be able to separate you from living for God. It says, shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine, your growth, persecution, distress, whatever you're going through, or nakedness or peril of sword, as it is written, for thy sake, we are killed all day long, and we're counted as sheep for slaughter. We're counted as sheep for slaughter. We're killed. You're going to go through it. Nay, all these things we have are more than conquerors for him that loved us. Says, Lord, give the assurance that through all the craziness, through all the craziness that you go through in life, the suffering, the persecution, the pain, the agony, all these different things, says, we are more than conquerors for him that loved us. Just don't give up. We are more. Ms. Bauer,